It was a small boy. He was bitterly disappointed as not being cast as Joseph in the school nativity play. And so the story goes, throughout all the rehearsals, he was given a minor job. Instead of the role he wanted as Joseph, he was given the role as the innkeeper. And so through all the rehearsals, weeks of rehearsals, this young man was just steaming, and he was plotting and trying to think how he would get his revenge on his enemy, who became Joseph in the play. So he spent all this time over the weeks just brooding over this. So finally the night of the program came, and the story began to unfold, and Mary and Joseph made their entrance, and they walked to the door of the inn and knocked on the door, and the innkeeper cracked it just by a small portion and peered out with a mean look. Joseph stepped forward and he said, "Sir, would you have room for me and my wife tonight in your inn? She's pregnant and expecting a child." This was the moment this innkeeper had been waiting for weeks. So he took the door and he flung it open and he said, "Come on in, come on in." He said, "I'll give you the best suite in the house." There was an eerie pause and people gasped. And finally, this young Joseph, he stepped forward and he said, "Wait a minute." He said, "Let me look inside. You stay right here, Mary." And he peered in the door behind the innkeeper and he backed up and he said, "I wouldn't bring my wife into a place like this. Come on, Mary, we'll spend the night in the stable." And the story was saved. And the story went on. You know, we hear this story a lot. I've heard it all my life. You have too. And we've seen the nativity all of our life. Very familiar. I mean, you could close your eyes this morning and you could describe the nativity scene. The shepherds and the sheep and cattle and the three wise men, Mary and Joseph. And then there's baby Jesus in the manger. We could describe that. We're very familiar with that. We see it in neighborhood yards, and our neighborhood people display it in their yards. We see it displayed in storefronts. We see it on postcards and Christmas cards. I mean, we see it all around us. Everywhere this year, we see the nativity surrounding us. Whether you're a Christ follower or not, whether you're into the whole church thing or not, I mean, we're all familiar with the nativity and the characters of the nativity. And though we've seen it all of our lives, what I'd like to do this morning is spend just a few moments to look at some things that maybe we haven't looked at in the nativity scene. Look at things this morning that maybe we've overlooked, maybe that we've missed somewhere along the way. This morning I want to invite you to look at three things that maybe has often gotten overlooked in the whole nativity in the story. And let me just say up front, first of all, Jesus. That's the main thing. He is the main thing. He is the reason. But I want to talk to you about three other things that maybe kind of get overlooked. And first of all, I want you to focus this morning on the star. Most nativity scenes, most movies, most stories of the nativity, they always have this star that appears in the sky and is taken right out of Scripture. In fact, Scripture tells us that God commissioned a particular star to serve as a travel guide to a group of men from the east who had developed an interest in finding the Christ child. And not only did this particular star lead these group of Easterners to Jerusalem and then on to Bethlehem, but it led them to the exact location of Mary, Joseph, and this Christ child. In fact, Scripture states that these wise men, they rejoiced over the fact that God had provided them with a remarkably accurate guide, a travel guide that had led them to Christ. And deep down, they knew they'd have never found the Christ child without the star, the Christmas star, God's gift of direction, His travel guide for seekers. I want you to look at the star maybe just a little bit differently this morning and look at it as a symbol of the fact that God has always provided a travel guide for those who earnestly seek Him. Jeremiah 29, he said it best. He said, "You'll find me when you seek me and you look for me in earnest. Yes, says the Lord, I will be found by you." You see, throughout history, God has seen to it that those who diligently seek after Him will find Him. Many here this morning, you are dedicated Christ followers, and we can all look back on a time in our life when we were searching for something in our life, we were missing something in our life. There was an emptiness, there was a void, there was a hunger, there was something in us that needed to be filled. And remember what God did? Remember what God did in your life and He did in my life? He provided us with a guide. He provided us with a star, so to speak, that led us to a relationship with Him. Maybe it was a mom or dad. Maybe it was your son or your daughter. Maybe it was a close friend or coworker or your spouse. Maybe it was a teacher or a coach or a neighbor. Or maybe it was a pastor. Maybe it was a Sunday school teacher. It was someone. We can retrace our spiritual journey back to someone who we could say, without that person, without that teacher, without that pastor, without that family member, without this friend, I would have never found Christ the way I know Him today. You see, God had someone to cross our path whose light was bright, whose love was real, and whose faith was so compelling that we found ourselves trusting that person to lead us into a relationship with Jesus Christ. What would some of our lives be like today? Where would we be? What would we be? What would we be doing had it not been for an earthbound star that God placed in our life that led us to a relationship with His Son, Jesus Christ? I say all that to say this morning, Christ followers, believers, wouldn't it be great today to just stop and pause and thank God for the star or the stars that He put in your life, the people that God used to lead you to where you are today in a relationship with God? One more word before we move on to believers here, let me just say this. Shine. Shine. Jesus said these words in Matthew 5:16. He said, "Let your light so shine before men that they will see your moral excellence and your praiseworthy and noble and good deeds and recognize and honor and praise and glorify your Father who is in heaven." Live in a way that when others watch you, that you can lead them to a relationship with Christ. And let me just say this, you may never know who's watching you and who's following you. The question is, where will we lead them? I had the opportunity this week, I was making a hospital visit, someone that didn't attend our church. I've known this lady for quite a while, and she's 91 years old. She was in the hospital, and I found out, went by to see her, and as I was visiting with her, her daughter was sitting by the bedside, and we were talking and reminiscing over some of the years, and her daughter made a statement, and the elderly lady in the bed made the same statement. She said, "You know what?" She said, "Thanks to you," she said, "my 3 grandchildren are serving God today because of some youth events that you did. They don't even live in this town, but they would come for these youth events." And she said, "Thank you for the input you had in their life." I walked out of that room that day, and I was like, what did I do? I don't remember doing anything specifically, but what I realized this week was they watched. They watched the direction that I was going and that others around them were going, and they followed. And as of today, they and their families are serving Christ. You never know who's watching you. The question is, where will you lead them? So believers, shine. Shine. You may be here this morning and you say, "You know, I feel more like the one that's seeking than the one that's shining. I feel more like the one that's trying to find my way than the one that knows the way." And you feel like you're going around in circles and you feel as spiritually detached this year as you did last year. And as you look into the next year, you're kind of honest with yourself and going, "I don't see things really changing significantly in my life." Then let me give you a word of encouragement, is that chances are good that God has already placed a travel guide in your life somewhere, somehow. Scan the relationships in your life, people that you already know, someone whose spiritual light burns bright and someone whose love is real and someone whose faith has caught your attention maybe more than once. That person may very well be God's gift to you. That person may very well be the travel guide that God has sent to this earth to lead you into a relationship with His Son. You may say, I know, but it's just my wife, or it's just my husband, or it's just my kids. They get all spiritual and emotional. It's just my neighbor, or it's just my folks, or it's just a classmate, and we kind of dismiss it. But let me give you a word of caution. Let God determine the best way to bring you to his son. The wise men, they'd have probably preferred a more personalized guide, I would think. But the point is, they were responsive to the guide that God brought into their life. We should be too, however it comes, through whoever it comes. Look at the star. God's probably given you one already in your life. Let me encourage you to use it. Use it soon. Another thing in the Nativity, I think, that we often overlook is the stable. Wooden hut. A wooden hut. The Nativity makers, always they make it look so nice and tidy and so neat and so cute. But the stable was anything but that. It was like 1,000 other stables around. It was crowded with smelly, dirty farm animals. It was dark and damp and rodent infested and animal waste everywhere. It was overall rotten place to birth a baby. Which makes a thinking person ask this question. If God could commandeer a star as a travel guide to lead people to his child, certainly he could have commandeered a room at the Bethlehem Hilton, or he could have got him a private room at a hospital somewhere. I mean, if God could do all that he did, certainly he could provide a better birthplace for his son than a stable. And the answer to that question is yes, he could have, but he made a deliberate choice not to. You see, God chose the stable for his son to be born in for a very important reason. When God sent his only son to this earth to live here, he made a strategic decision not to shelter his son from the harsh realities of life. God wanted his son to experience life in the real world. Jesus' first breath burned with the odor of animal waste. The first noises he heard were the grunts of the livestock. The outfit that he wore was made out of dust cloth and rags. From day one, God determined not to shelter his son from the rude, crude realities of life on this planet. You may say, but why? Why would God do that? What was the purpose of having his son born in a stable? Because had he come as a king and been born in a palace and lived a royal life, he couldn't have identified with you and me or most people on this planet. Because he had come as king and born in a palace and lived a royal life, we couldn't have identified with him. Because kings don't live where we live, and kings don't eat what we eat, and kings don't work like we work, and kings don't suffer and experience a lot of the things that we experience in life. So he came as a humble babe in a manger, born in a stable. He had humble beginnings, more humble than any of us in this room. He was born in a stable. He worked a construction job most of his life. He lived in a neighborhood. He had ordinary friends. He suffered hardships just like we do. And he died a cruel death on a cross for a crime that he never committed. So let the stable serve as a reminder of the fact that God sent his son into this world, this real world, to experience life like we experience life. So when the Bible urges people who are going through disappointment and pain to pour out their hearts to the Savior, we as Christ followers can do so with absolute certainty that Jesus hears us, that Jesus understands, and that Jesus has been where we are at. Life without advantage, he lived it. Discrimination, oppression, Jesus was a refugee before his first birthday. Rejection, he experienced it. Ridicule was a part of his daily life. Abandonment by his lifelong friends at the most crucial time in his life. Physical pain, more than you and I will ever, ever understand. So whatever you experience in life, and whatever drives you within an inch of your breaking point, whatever you experience that hurts so deeply that you want to cry out, I can't go on any further because nobody understands the way I feel. Let me encourage you just to stop. Take a moment and look at the stable. And be reminded this Christmas that God understands, that God cares. God feels what you feel. He's been there. He identifies with you. You matter to Him. He loves you more than you can ever, ever imagine. In fact, the writer of Hebrews said this: it was necessary for Him to be made in every respect like us, His brothers and sisters, so that He could be our merciful and faithful high priest before God. Then He could offer a sacrifice that could take away the sins of the people. Since He Himself has gone through suffering and testing, He's able to help us when we're being tested. Can you see how important the stable is? It symbolizes the deliberate, unsheltered life of Jesus, and it stands as a monument to His ability to identify and sympathize with what we're going through. However, we have to be humble and trusting enough to pour our hearts out to Him and then allow His love to heal us and restore us and to bring us to wholeness again. We've seen the star, we've seen the stable, and one last thing I'd like for us to look at is the place where Jesus was laid. He was laid in a manger. A manger. Not a first century bassinet with all the frilly stuff on it, but He was laid in a manger. Nothing more, a manger was nothing more than a feed trough for cattle. It was a crudely constructed piece of farm furniture. It was ordinary in every way. You would find them in every stable that you went in, whether it was big or small. They all had this crude constructed piece of farm furniture, a feed trough for cattle called a manger. And if you think about it, the only reason we're familiar with the word manger is because of one little clip of Scripture that says God's Son was laid in one. Apart from that, we wouldn't have a clue as to what a manger was. Because God's Son was laid in a feed trough or in a manger, look what happened to an ordinary piece of farm furniture. All of a sudden, it takes on a new dignity. It's a household word. If you're driving to Dothan, you'll see a manger on steroids on the right side of the road. As you go into Dothan, there's this big, huge manger sitting out in front of a church. The only way we would know what it was, that we even know what a manger is because it was mentioned in Scripture. The ordinary becomes the extraordinary. A feed trough for cattle becomes a cradle for a king. That's quite a transformation. The manger stands as a symbol of what can happen to an ordinary man or woman when Jesus Christ resides in our life. It's a symbol of what has happened to thousands of people around the world and what's happened to many people in this room this morning. Ordinary lives that have been changed through the presence of Christ in their life. Ordinary people who saw themselves for what they really were, lawbreakers. They were sinners in God's eyes, and they could say that. They could say, I'm a sinner. These ordinary people recognized that they couldn't change their past and they were probably not going to be able to change their future and that they would stand totally guilty on Judgment Day before God. And these ordinary people, they first fell on their knees in repentance. And they said, God, I see who You are and I see who I am and I see that I have come in way short of where I need to be. And I repent. The second thing they did is we cried out for mercy and for grace. We thanked God that He didn't give us what we deserved, and we also thanked Him that He did give us what we didn't deserve. He offered us grace. He did for us what we could not do for ourselves. And the third thing is that we bowed in worship to God. We bowed and acknowledged that He is a loving Father, a loving God who sent His Son, Jesus, for our salvation, to offer us forgiveness of our sin, for a merciful and gracious God, and we acknowledge Him in worship that He is Lord and He is Savior and Master of our lives. See, the manger reminds us when Jesus Christ takes residency in an ordinary life, the ordinary becomes the extraordinary. Paul said this is what This means that anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old life is gone. The new life has begun. And just as a feed trough becomes a king's cradle, an average man or an average woman becomes exceptional through the responsiveness and acceptance of Christ into their life. You see, God does to humans what Jesus did for the manger. He makes something that was ordinary, extraordinary. From sinners and outsiders to his very own children, a part of his family. So I guess the question is this morning. Will you allow Jesus to bring about that kind of transformation in your life? Will you allow him to bring to your life the ordinary, our ordinary life? Will you allow him to bring us to the extraordinary, to change us? You see, Jesus Christ can transform your life from being just a good person and trying to do good and trying to just to live a good life. He can transform you from that to becoming one of his sons and daughters, a part of his family. That's the miracle of the manger, from ordinary to extraordinary. So as you leave here today, you'll probably pass a nativity somewhere along the way on your way home, or you may be out riding this evening and you'll pass one, someone's yard or downtown or somewhere, and you'll see a nativity. And when you do, I hope you'll pause for a moment and you'll look at the star and you'll either thank God for the people in your life that led you to a relationship with God, or maybe you'll pause and contemplate the people that are in your life that God wants to use to lead you to a relationship with him. And then when you look at the stable, that you'll remember as you look at the stable that God made a deliberate choice not to shelter his son, but to have his son live life just like we live it, so that he could identify with us and be a sympathetic savior. And then when you see the manger, I hope that you remember that God can take the ordinary and change it to the extraordinary. Choice is ours, and the choice, I think, is very simple this Christmas. You can watch another Christmas go by, doing it your way, and have no real change. Or you can fall on your knees this Christmas, and you can repent, and you can welcome the Christ of Christmas to come into your life, and to turn the ordinary into the extraordinary. I want to pray for you. Father, I thank you for this time, this season. This is what it's all about. Had there not been a Savior sent to this earth, we would all be miserably lost. But you loved and cared enough for us that you sent us a Savior, and you didn't send him in a palace somewhere far removed from us. You sent him in an ordinary stable, born in a manger, surrounded by livestock and shepherds. That you sent him so that he could identify with us. Father, I pray this morning that if there's one in the room who looks at their life and thinks, I'm just ordinary, there's nothing special about me, that today, God, would be the moment that they open their heart to you and they invite the Savior, Christ, to take up residence in their life so that their ordinary life will be transformed into the extraordinary. God, thank you for the gift of your Son and for loving us so much. We ask this in Christ's name. Amen. I would encourage you, if you have prayed to ask Christ to come into your life, on the back